Before I start, I want to ask you a question. How many of you have been to any ancient monument? Can we have see the hands? Wow. Now my next question is, how many of you have seen any monument or anybody making a carving similar to what you have seen? Can we see the hands? Very few. Now this is what I'm going to talk about. That's my passion and that is my life. Let us start first with the Kadamba Hoysala Mandap. I want to present the heritage which was created and long lost. It's a fine stone craftsmanship which was lost for last 4 to 5 centuries. The beautiful schist carvings, the ornate ones, which was again something which Hoysalas, Chalukyas did, which was again lost for last 7 centuries. The magnificent wooden pillar and the wooden typology associated with it, again lost in last 2 centuries. Now the question is, did we lose it all? Was this lost to humanity? Was it lost forever? No. We recreated it back. Not only we recreated it back, we revived building practices associated with it. The stone mandap, the schist carvings, the magnificent wooden pillar and wooden pillar typology associated with it. How did this happen? Let me start and share with you my journey. I was born in an idyllic village, tranquil, with green hills and a temple in the center and a pond. In fact, that is where I spent most of my time, childhood, playing. My image of the world was very serene. I looked at the world as a very serene with a temple and all green around it. As I grew up, I started realizing that there are many such places in the world. World is full of such wonderful places. In fact, world is a mosaic of diverse geographies, different cultural communities and their own building practices. Now, why building practices are important to us? They are important because a building tells you a lot about the generation that created it. It outlasts that generation. And it tells you about the civilization which created and nurtured it. India, a splendid civilization. But the most important character of that is that it is continuous. There is a continuity. Unlike many other civilizations, it is one of the few civilizations where there is a sense of continuity. Continuity from primeval to ancient, from ancient to medieval, and from medieval to the contemporary period. There has been the continuity in building practices and they have survived. In fact, most astounding fact is that all these periods coexist at the moment in this continent. Don't believe me? Go to Central India. You'll find Madhya tribes building the same way they built 3,000 years back. Go to the eastern shores. You will find Shilpis crafting, generations of who created great temple of Konark. They are capable of recreating it. Go to deep south. Go to Kumbakonam. Go to Mahabalipuram, Kanyakumari. You will find all people are capable of creating back that glory of the past. Now how was this possible? Because these generations gave their life, invested their life perfecting skills, transferring it to their children, again transferring to their children. A continuous process. This is what I call living traditions of India. Traditions of knowledge, traditions of technology. In fact, it is best summed up in a verse, Namah Purvajayacha, salutations to the ancestors. Namah Parajayacha, salutations to the ones yet to come. This continuity is like a river. Just like river grows in the mountain from a tiny source, joined by many springs together to form a great mass of water which nourishes civilizations, collecting, depositing, giving, taking. Ancient, yet the drop of water which you lift out of it has just arrived. That's the essence. Living traditions have formed from very primeval sources, tribal origins, Vedic philosophies, Buddhist developments, and subsequent development across various periods. Period of Ashoka, period of Magadha, period of Maurya in north, whereas Chola, Pallava, Pandya in south. How did this happen? Because each one of them put that energy. Each of these generations' historical periods invested, contributed, utilized. A continuous process, mind you, it's a 3,000-year continuous process happening in this country. However, last few decades, what has happened is that the world around these communities have changed. And the change has been so rapid. There is industrialization, there is urbanization, there is a transition from villages to cities. Now, this has created a break in their traditions. Some have become absolute, while some symbolic. Now, the last bastion where this thing has survived is temple architecture and the Tirtha. When I realized this, it was like a full realization. I had come back in full circle, back to my childhood, temple and the pond. It gave me a lot of purpose and sense of what my achievement in life is going to be, where I'm going to invest my life. So I set out to revive these traditions. In fact, myself, my wife Rashmi Sadhale, my father Kamalakar Sadhale, we all strived along with few spirited individuals to revive it at every level of its existence. At the level of city planning, area development projects, where we tried to imbibe ancient thoughts of planning models with modern infrastructural requirements. At the level of design of temple, monument, space, element. At the level of craftsmanship of various nature. Even the idols which we made were made in a historically appropriate style. It doesn't stop here. In fact, do you know that even the water conservation, a hot topic now, was a part of the living traditions? These practices and these techniques associated with water conservation and related to temple planning models, or going further than that, even village planning models, we are trying to revive it and replicate it in a modern projects. Now, in today's world, where there is a water scarcity, incorporating all this information into our planning models would certainly help us in creating sustainable city planning. City planning as envisaged in living traditions, it envisages creating a coexistence where all beings survive together. The resources belong to every living being. It is not just a human being. In fact, Ishopanishad sums it in a very beautiful way. It says, nobody has a right to take resources belonging to another living being. Taking inspiration from this, we started out in promoting, making people realize the linkages between culture and nature. We focused on preservation, conservation of Devrais, the sacred forest. Now, how many of you have seen Devra is here? Can we have see the hands? Very few. But those are the sacred forest, preserved bioreserves, where a species remains intact for a long time, undisturbed. You cannot pick up a single leaf out of it. That good. And mind you, in Goa, there are almost 40 such Devrais. Please take out time to visit them. We also focused on Vana concept, incorporating plant species with a cultural significance as a part of a biodiversity parks. And this all can be incorporated in modern projects. Conserving or sustaining living traditions required to take all three components of that together. Three components were the knowledge, the practice, and the people. Now, knowledge was there in form of 200 and plus, I don't know how many, 200 and plus treatises composed over last 1,700 years. Practices were also vast. The major task for us was to relate both these things together. Which text applies to which region, which historical style? The third component was the people. There were pockets of people surviving even in this today's century. There were Sompuras in the north who are temple builders. You had Stapatis, the traditional planner builders. In south, you had Tachan, the carpenters. You had Shilpis. You had Acharis, the metal craftsmanship. We had to collect all of them together. And we started working at two ends of it. At one end, we tried to promote the knowledge, the skill among these people. At the other end, we tried to create a base of appreciation for people, in people, so that they will give these people a chance to execute. That is the only way it will work. You had to bring in profitability, marketability, and economic sustenance so the next generations can continue. We also focused on continuity of styles where it was broken. The Kadamba Nagar style of especially Goa and Karnataka, I think how many of you have seen temples of this nature in Karnataka or Goa? Can you see the hands? Good. Then Bhumija in central India, we tried to revive it. Not only revive it, we train the craftsmen, artisans in making such structures again. We also focused on training people, executing projects of various nature, not stuck to any particular typology. We had walls, arch, wooden structures, different kinds of structures. We also focused on schist craftsmanship. That was also revived. Now, apart from schist craftsmanship, there was a lot of other areas like wooden craftsmanship, there was a copper craftsmanship, metal craftsmanship. All this had to be revived. That is the only way it would go further. We did not stop here. We did not stop with this building or hard material. We went to the paintings also. Now, before I say anything about this painting, I want to know how many of you are residents in Goa here? Can I see the hands? How many of you have seen this painting? Can I see his hand? Yeah, one hand. This is the longest vegetable dye painting in India, executed on a handmade canvas in Goa at Mallikarjun Temple at Kankon. It was a training exercise, fantastic training exercise for all the craftsmen, painters, for iconographers, the branch which studies the iconography or idols, for future generations to relish. What is our purpose? Do we want to bring back some old era, some historical period, golden era? No, we don't want to do that. We want to revive these building techniques, practices, and as a whole, living traditions, so that we are able to dwell back and connect back to our past where it has been left off. and then there is a continuity which can grow into the future. Now, this requires a lot of support. I request all of you to come and join this river of living traditions. I have chosen building practices. But you can choose whatever you are passionate about. It could be the water conservation, or it could be the environmental conservation, it could be the trees, it could be the dwelling. But please share it with your children. Make them part of it, because that is the only way forward. Thank you.